Giri Govardhan ki jai. Vrindavan Mathura dham ki jai. Navadvip Mayapur dham ki jai. Bhakti Devi ki jai. Tulsi Devi ki jai. Samaveda Bhakta Vrinda ki jai. Samaveda Bhakta Vrinda ki jai. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskrityam. Naram Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam. Tato Jaya Mudirae. Nashtaprayeshu Abhadreshu. Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Bhagavati Uttama Shloke. Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtaki. So we're reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 13, chapter entitled The Hansa Avatar Answers Questions, text number 34. Please repeat after me. Ikshita vibramam idam manasaha vilasam trishtam vinashtam atilolam alata chakram vijnanam ekam urudha eva Vibhati, Vibhati, Maya, Swapna, Tridha, Guna, Visarga, Krita, Vikalpa. Iksheta vibramamidam manaso vilasam. Trishtam vinashtam atilolam alachakram Vignanam ekam rudha deva vibhati maya Swapna stridha guna visarga krito vikalpa Iksheta vibramam idam manaso vilasam Trishtam vinastam atilolam alata chakram. Vijnanam amekam urudheva vibhati maya. Swapna stridha guna nivisarga krito vikalpa. Iksheta vibramam idam manaso vilasam. Trishtam vinastam atilolam alata chakram. Vignanam ekam urudheva vibhati maya. Swapna stridha guna visarga krito vikalpa. Iksheta vibramam idam manaso vilasam. Trishtam vinashtam atilolam alata chakram. Vignanam ekam urudheva vibhati maya. Swapna Sridha Guna Visarga Krita Vikalpa Vishtam Astam Matilola Vilasavaktam Vignanamekam Vrudeva Vibhati Maya Nasti Dhaguna Visarga Krito Galpa Viksheta Vibramam Idam Manaso Vilasam Drishtam Vinastam Atilola Malata Chakram Vignanam Ekamarudeva Vibhati Maya Ladies, it's a tough one. Okay, Ikshetra, one should see Vibhramam as illusion or mistake, Idam, this material world, Manasaha, of the mind, Vilasam, appearance or jumping. Drishtam, here today. Vinastam, gone tomorrow. Ati lolam, extremely flickering. Alata chakram, just like the moving red line created by whirling a fiery stick. Vignanam, the spirit soul, by nature fully conscious. Ekam is one, Urudha in many divisions. Eva, as if, Vibhuti appears, Maya, this is illusion, Swapna, merely a dream, Tridha in three divisions, Guna, of the modes of nature, Visarga, by the transformation, Krita, created, Vikalpa, variety of perception or imagination. Translation and purport by the disciples of Srila Prabhupada. Translation, one should see that the material world is a distinct illusion appearing in the mind, because material objects have an extremely flickering existence, and are here today and gone tomorrow. They can be compared to the streaking red line created by whirling a fiery stick. The spirit soul by nature exists in the single state of pure consciousness. However, in this world, he appears in many different forms and stages of existence. The modes of nature divide the soul's consciousness into normal wakefulness, dreaming, and dreamless sleep. All such varieties of perception, however, are actually Maya and exist only like a dream. Purport. The Lord now describes an additional process for transcending the illusory interaction of the material mind and material sense objects. Lasa means jumping or dancing, and thus Manaso Vilasam here indicates that the material mind is jumping superficially from one conception of life to another. Our original consciousness, however, is one, Vignanam Ekam. Therefore, one should carefully study the flickering, here today, gone tomorrow, nature of the material world and detach oneself from the illusory variety of Maya. Om Ajnanta Mirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Asmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam. Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Nagna Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha E Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Manchakalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhuva Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Nama Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shrivas Adigaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. So here the central point which is really continuing in the last few verses, and one of the major themes of this chapter is how the illusion can cover our consciousness, our thinking. And this we can see in two ways. One is even whether we are aspiring to be a devotee or not, everybody is actually covered under this illusion. And that is the main reason why we are here in the first place. But what, you know, Srila Prabhupada's lectures, if you hear, and then subsequently his disciples also, one of the prominent themes constantly, which was very new to me, because this is not what we hear generally till we come to spiritual discourse, that this material world is full of danger, padam padam vipadam satesham. Constantly we heard this so often, and it's not a kind of a morbid desire to just talk about or to be some kind of a psychic problem that we keep on thinking of, well, my next step will be danger. But as we grow, as we really reflect on our life and details, particularly after we have got some knowledge from spiritual life, we actually understand that this is actually very, very true. As we grow older, we have also seen, you know, people depart suddenly. We have suddenly out of the blue, some challenge comes or the other. It can be any type. It can be personal, could be health related, could be external. You know, challenges, problems are there. So we know that unexpectedness is the nature of this material world. Uncertainty is the nature of this material world. So this fear, at the same time, to live in morbid fear is not the solution. Because getting the understanding, knowledge of why this is, how this is the case and why it is, and if Krishna has designed it that way, then what is the purpose? And how do we deal with it for the years that we have? And more important, how do we transcend that in such a way that we actually take that as a kind of motivation for us to turn towards Krishna. Often we see that when there is a challenge, we can rise to the challenge if we are motivated. Like in exams also, some people are really motivated when they are very much, I mean, there's a kind of apprehension, fear, maybe, you know. But then if the student is a sincere, diligent student, then he will rise to the occasion. He'll actually take up the challenge. Same way, we, a student of spiritual life, will take this as a motivation, because knowing that this is knowledge coming from Krishna. So he's giving the question, he's giving the challenge, he's also giving the solution. So an intelligent person would like to see that what are the solutions. So before we come to that, if we just Prabhupada has nicely explained in one lecture about the nature of illusion, and he said broadly there are two types. And sometimes Krishna will put his devotee, he means arranges such a way that his devotee is in, you know, kind of put in illusion, but actually it's for the benefit of others. And we'll take an example of that. And sometimes Krishna allows his sincere devotee to be, you know, kind of influenced under, it looks as if he's influenced under material energy, and actually may suffer humiliation, may suffer problems, but then that devotee will seek a deeper shelter under the lotus feet. That means turn towards Krishna more so. So, in both the cases, let's take examples. In the first case where it is an example for the others, we can take the case of Arjun. Now, that is how Bhagavad Gita originated, that at Jyotisar, when Arjun was in so-called illusion, actually Arjun was playing his part. We have to understand that. You know, it is just like in a drama, somebody plays a part. The Bhagavad Gita is meant for every living being. It's for us. So he was playing our part. He was a pure devotee, he's a liberated soul. He's the best friend of Krishna. So clearly, it's not as if he was, though it was the entire Mahabharata, the way it has been brought in so wonderfully and right to that level where Arjun actually brings up those issues which even a pious person would generally bring. But one would still think, without knowing that conclusion, we would say, how is it that being the best friend of Krishna, how is it that he's allowing his material relationship to become an attachment? How is it that this attachment makes him lose his intelligence? And we may sit and say that, well, the conclusion of Krishna consciousness is, well, we have to surrender to Krishna, we have to follow him. And how is it that the only goal is to please Krishna, and here he is so close to physically to Krishna, he's been his best friend, he doesn't know this. This is what somebody with you know, in an immature way we may think. But this is what the purpose of Bhagavad Gita is, to know that, to tell us that there is danger at every step, there is challenges at every step. This material world is a temporary world. We are going to have, and we do suffer on and off. And then what we consider pleasure is actually an absence of, temporary absence of problems. You know, it's like a person who's put under water for 10 seconds and then his head is brought up. When he's gasping for air, he thinks that is pleasure. That's what Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur gave their example. So we try to understand, and that's what Arjun is trying to bring this, by his playing this role. That he's, the questions he raises about his attachments and his, because he's led a very exemplary life, and then he gets motivated enough. But because he exclusively puts aside everything for the next, say, 1.5 hours or so, and listens to Krishna and Jyotisar, he gets that motivation to fight, and then he practically wins the war for righteousness. So that is a lesson also for us, that actually putting aside exclusively and hearing from Krishna or his representatives is key. It is not a secondary thing, or it is not something which can be among other things. We can't compartmentalize and say that I could do this along with other things and then we can switch on and off. Yeah, the activities may change, but the consciousness, the larger consciousness of who we are, what we do, why we do it, and how we keep monitoring and measuring our approach has to be a regular feature. And to the extent that we take that seriously, to that extent we will be steady. To the extent that we kind of, you know, temporary lapse, to that extent we'll deviate. But fortunately, Krishna also says in Bhagavad Gita that there is no loss. whatever we have learned, whatever we have progressed, whatever understanding we've had at that time, even if we've forgotten temporarily, he'll bring us back. There's no doubt. But there's no time limit to it. So it could be, you know, we could suffer, we would have to go through the normal sufferings. So, primarily objective for us to know is that no matter how powerful or intelligent we may be, or wealthy we may be, or scientifically advanced we may be, no matter, irrespective of the person, if we do not follow Krishna's laws, we are bound to be frustrated. We are bound to be bewildered. And in that bewilderment, then our reactions could be completely uncontrolled at times. And a perfect example of this was when Srila Prabhupada went to the US in 1966. And then within a few years, then he was spending a lot of time there. So just a few years after that, the then President of the United States, who is the most powerful person probably in the entire world, that post is because this is considered one of the most powerful nation, and the one who heads that and is the commander-in-chief of that country is considered to be the most powerful person. And he had actively worked for coming to that level. He had campaigned and he had given so many efforts. Then he was elected. But then he made a mistake, and due to his greed and pride, he was ultimately forced to resign. It was a huge humiliation for him. So Prabhupada was there that time, and this president, when he resigned, he said famously, he was quoted, he said that that nobody in this world can be suffering as much as I am suffering today. And then many years later he died, and just shortly before his death he also had mentioned that I have never been able to forget this humiliation. So when he initially resigned, that time Prabhupada is detached from all this, so he saw this as a kind of humorous way of how Krishna's material, the entanglements can lead to. He's a very compassionate heart, but he can see that the perfect lesson, that the most powerful person, nobody is above the kind of frustration and bewilderment that can set in if we move away. So, if we have to take one single person, and let's say if that is the example, then who can be exempted? Nobody is exempted. So even the biggest position in the world could also be, you can be kicked out overnight. That is the way things could work. Then there's a story of Indra. Again, Prabhupada has mentioned this many times. When he made a mistake and he created offenses to a sage, and then he was cursed to be a hog. And then he came down, leaving all his palaces, apsaras, all his power and prestige and all, king of Swargalok, comes down to the world as a pig, as a hog. But then here he gets attached to his family and so on. And then when it was time to go back, when Brahmaji, the king of all the head of all the devtas and his other the devtas, when they were calling him back, and he was saying that no, I am, I've got my responsibilities here. I've got my family here. I don't want to come back, because he had got used to the life as a hog. And then Brahmaji then knew that he is now kind of an illusion. So he arranged for a farmer to come and kill his wife, the pig wife, and then his kids, the piglets. And then he was about to kill Brahmaji, Indra. And then Indra realized okay, I'm coming, ready to come back. So our situation is very much like that we will, in spite of, we can forget, even if you are coming to the temple, even if you are reading, if you do not work within the boundaries of what spiritual sanity can help us. You know, anytime we could be into forgetfulness, like Indra was, and then think that, no, I've got my various things to do, my duties to do, we can always justify various things. And then only when things are falling apart, our world is falling apart, then we will say, Krishna, save me. This is typically how it happened. The lesson for us here also is that, you know, going back to Krishna is not easy, but at the same time, he is there at all times holding our hand through his various representatives who come here and are there to, you know, take us. It's an open book exam. We're told what to write, we're told what to do. But if we don't pick up the pen and do it, then that's, I think it is only fair that, in fact, it is, we have to then accept the suffering. So, the other illusion where sometimes, you know, great devotees due to temptations of material energy get, and then they get affected and then they seek deeper kind of surrender to Krishna is the example would be of Bharat Maharaj. Bharat Maharaj was a very, very great king. In fact, this Bharat Varsh was named after him. And he was also the son of the Supreme Lord, King Rishabdev. And he ruled wonderfully for many years, perfectly actually. And then when the time came, he renounced everything and went to the forest to progress his spiritual life for the last parts of his life. So imagine he had reached the stage of perfection in the sense that he had done his duties in the most ideal manner, and he had now also given up such things which would be unthinkable to renounce after, you know, being the ruler of the whole world, all the trappings that he had and all the prestige, wealth, everything. And he went, but then when he went to the river Gandaki, where he set up his spiritual abode, and then one day one deer, mother deer who was pregnant, was running away from a lion and then trying to jump over the Gandaki river out of fear. And Bharat Maharaj was sitting there in meditation and he heard the roar of the lion, and out of fear that the deer, the mother deer, while she was crossing, only the baby fell from the womb into the river. So, all mothers love their children. When the mother looked and saw that the baby deer was drowning, it was like she was weeping bitterly, couldn't do anything, and she left, she gave up her life. In the meantime, Bharat Maharaj took, out of his compassion, he took the deer and he became very attached to it because he felt, I am the protector, I am the only person. So, and then slowly, it's a long story where it actually shows how he, his full consciousness was revolving around his, the small deer. What will the deer do without me, etc. So eventually, time came when Bharat Maharaj had to, when he was leaving this world, because his consciousness was only very much central around the most important thing that time for his life had become the deer. So he actually became, he got a body of a deer the next life. But because he had done such great tapasya, such great sacrifice, great services, he had the consciousness of a human being. So when he got the body of a deer, still, he was fully conscious. As he could see, he could understand everything from his past life, and he knew why he was a deer. So he vowed that I will not do anything this life to get into, to make any mistake. I made a big mistake last time. So even as a deer in the forest, it would always attend these satsangs and hover around sadhus, eat prasad or the leftovers of the sadhus, and therefore when the deer, Bharat Maharaj in the form of deer, when he left this world, the next time he came in as in the family of pious Brahmins, and that is when he came as Jad Bharat. So the Brahmin, the father was a great scholar, Pandit, and and then his brothers, that is Jad Bharat Maharaj, is, now Jad Bharat, his brothers also were very kind of ritualistic. I mean, they were Brahmins and they knew all the shlokas and everything. Now, but again, Jagbharat had fully retained the consciousness. He's a very exalted, pure devotee. So he didn't want to make any mistake now, this time. So he, he would be worried of, would be away from any kind of recognition or respect that you may get. So he actually started leading a life in such a way that nobody would even think of respecting him or recognizing him or giving him, you know, any kind of post, prestige, anything. So really living like a vagabond, he would do just the opposite of what people, his father would tell him, for instance, that, you know, you should, when you go to respond to nature, then immediately after that you should wash your hands. So he would wash his hands first and then go to respond to nature. So he would just do the opposite, and though his father was very patient with him and he tried to teach him, but the brothers and others, everyone thought he was crazy. So, and Bharat Maharaj was, in his internal consciousness, he was completely satisfied and completely cognizant of what was happening. So he didn't have any kind of effect. It didn't have any effect on him, this kind of response from the outside world. And he was oblivious and he had transcended that. But eventually when his father died, then his son, brothers, they felt that this was too much. And they just not only threw him out, because they felt it is bad for their prestige also. Because ultimately he was staying in the same house and, you know, his body had become black, his hair was matted. Because he was living in such a way that he just externally seemed to be living a completely non-human being existence. But if I actually, from a spiritual point of view, could see that he was living a life where he was completely unconcerned about his body and was living entirely according, means on the highest consciousness. He had reached that level, but others couldn't recognize it because nobody was at that level. So they put him as a scarecrow, thinking that's probably the best thing that he could do. You know, scarecrows, they just put generally some artificial body, could be stuffing with cotton or whatever, in the fields, so that, you know, it gets literally scare away the crows and other birds which would come and, you know, eat the grains. Because birds would think that there's somebody standing there. So he was actually made to stand just like that. Any other person would feel there's so much humiliation, but Bharat Maharaj was not in that. Jagbharat was, you know, beyond all the things. And he was quite happy. He said, if Krishna is happy, I'm happy. So basically, his concern was only to see that he leads this life with complete detachment, because he knew that, you know, detachment from the spirit, world, only then you get the attachment to Krishna. Because he knew more than anyone else. We only hear his story. He lived that story, so he knew what it was to be attached to a deer, and without a very good feelings. Nobody can fault his compassionate nature. But where is that thin line which goes into attachment? He was very worried of that. So he, this time he was he completely focused on living the life which should be totally, you know, smaranam of Krishna. So in that context he went on standing there in the fields. And with all this kind of humiliation with him, but he didn't mind. And one day, this gang of dacoits, they were out looking to see that, because they were all worshippers of goddess Kali, and they used to offer human beings to goddess Kali, and they were looking for a fit candidate. And that way Jagbharat, you know, his bodily strength was also very, didn't eat any junk food, so obviously he was probably quite fit. So they took him and they tied him up, and he didn't give any resistance, just went along with them. And then they were about to kill him, and when they were about to, the leader was about to bring the sword down on his neck, literally just seconds away, and goddess Kali, who, this is Bhadrakali, I think this was in Kurukshetra, I think, So the temple there, so they, the Kali, of course, she's actually a pure devotee. She would never accept human beings. So anyone who's offering, then she would give it to the ghosts and the hobgoblins and others. But here, when this was happening in front of her, so she actually came out of the deity form and along with her associates and took the sword from the leader's head and chopped off the leader's head, the dacoit's head. And then the associates also killed all the other dacoits. And in the meantime, in fact, they paid obeisances to Bharat Maharaj, Jagat Bharat. They understood that he's a very great exalted soul. But he was, Jagat Bharat was completely non-cognizant of this. He just walked off into the jungles. And there again he was wandering around. People were criticizing him and you know, calling him crazy, you know, throw stones at him. But he was not affected. And then one day King Rahuguna, who was the king of the land, he King Rahuguna was also a very great king. And it is said that he was actually in search of a spiritual master. So he was going in a palanquin. So the palanquin was being carried by four strong men, and one of them had got injured. So they were looking for somebody to replace that injured palanquin carrier so that the four could balance each other. So then the servants were and soldiers were looking around, and then they found this person wandering and available. So they took him there and got him to carry the palanquin. But such was Bharat Maharaj's, Jagat Bharat's compassionate nature and his awareness, his wakefulness, let's say, of every moment and everything, every living being, that even when he was walking with the palanquin, even an ant also in front of him, he was cognizant that he might harm the ant. So just to avoid harming any smallest creature which he could see, he could barely see, you know, he would actually very sensitively walk alongside or move from there, you know, just sidestep and go forward. Now, if four people are carrying a palanquin, if one person keeps moving around left and right, obviously it's going to upset the rhythm. And our King Rahuguna was not having a very smooth ride, is getting bumpy rides. So he was naturally very upset and angry at what is happening. So after repeated corrections, Jagat Bharat was not changing his habit, because for him that was the most important thing. He didn't mind whatever penalties would come to him. So then finally then, you know, a confrontation took place. Rahuguna not only got first very upset, got very angry, but eventually when he understood, when Jagat Bharat started speaking, he had not spoken for practically his entire life, but he was so realized because he had understood everything. So whatever he spoke, immediately Rahuguna, the king, who was also a devotee, immediately understood the value of this wisdom of this great soul, and he immediately surrendered to him. So the king actually surrendered to Jagat Bharat. So we can see that you know, it is not the externals that count, it is the internal consciousness. And but here the most important point for us is in terms of illusion is that even such a great devotee as Bharat Maharaj and in his three lives, Jagat Bharat, was not exempt from illusion. So Krishna has given this really to see, because ultimately he's been glorified when millions of people over millions of years have spoken about it, that glorifying him. But nevertheless, there is a lesson for us in that nobody is exempt from that. So even if you're in devotional service, Maya can trick us in so many ways. So for our sake, in our case, then in the practical issues of whether, you know, we may be helping the temple in some way, either by distributing books or garland seva or any services we do, arranging programs, directly preaching or indirectly helping, donating, we may still feel that we are doing something. And that is, that awareness has to be, we have to cultivate and question ourselves all the time. Just like Bharat Maharaj was so cognizant and aware of everything. Because we may not be at that level, but that's the lesson for us, is that we have to always self-examine, because we don't know when this pride moves in. And this pride comes in such a subtle way. This Maya works in such a subtle way that we would never know. It is very imperceptible. And gradually, it changes our thinking, our consciousness. And, before we know it, our propensity to serve would be gradually reduced. Our desire to come to association of devotees starts going down. Our desire to follow the whatever determination we have that we have been told, that starts going down. So slowly we get withdrawn, and it may be later that we realize it, but oftentimes it may be too late. So a very nice analogy was given by His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj once when he was mentioning this about it's just like a material person. It's like he is sleeping in the night with his front door open. So it is like you are inviting the thief to come in. It's crazy, one would say, but yes, if you actually do it, what does happen? That the thief comes in and he takes whatever he wants and he steals away. So the prudent thing is to lock the doors, lock the windows, and protect yourself completely. Because even if there is a small crack, then a trained thief would be able to find it. So similarly, our situation is like that, that if we let our doors open, that means we just we lead our life according to our whims, our senses, our desires, not according to the laws of Krishna, to Krishna's representative's guidance, then we are exactly the same situation. And we would be allowing the thief of Maya to come in and steal our greatest treasure. Our treasure is our consciousness. That's the highest treasure. That so if we have even got a little bit of understanding, we are in danger of being removed, of being taken away. Prabhupada gave a wonderful story once about a camel in a desert. Winter time, freezing. In the nights it can get very, very freezing cold. So there's this Arab man is in the tent and his camel is outside, and then the camel, this person is inside the tent, but he's not, but the camel wants to get in. So the camel keeps pleading with him that, please, I'm feeling so cold, my nose is so cold, okay, let me just put my nose in that. So then he allows, finally, after a lot of persuasion, then that man said, okay, only your nose. So he only puts his nose in the tent so that I can get some heat. After some time, then he, says, my eyes are actually so cold, I can't even see. So again, he keeps pleading, and then he says, okay, only your eyes. And then he says, the camel's most beautiful part of the body is the neck, and my neck is frozen, I can't even bend, I don't know, I can't even feel it. Okay, only the neck. Slowly then it became the hind legs, the front legs, gradually, and then he took over the tent, and the man was outside, and the camel was inside. So our position is similar. What Prabhupada is mentioning is that we, if you allow even a small crack, and that crack is by being careless, like if you are negligent of what, of your confident, complacent, then we are actually allowing this small crack to develop into a big thing, and then before we know it, we would be then in bewilderment. And we may not even have the determination to rectify it. So it's we have to be very cautious. So Prabhupada then used to say that, how do you protect yourself? They said, you protect yourself by, four regulative principles. That is the starting point. And then to fill your mind with whatever is suitable to Krishna consciousness. And then to the extent that you fill, you have a whole glass, a whole tank. If you fill it fully, then there's no crack. If you fill it three quarters, you have a risk that there is still some gap. So our consciousness, our mind, now that would be into various things. We have a worldly duties also. So to the extent that all that we do, everything that we follow or do, is linked to Krishna consciousness, not just linked but under the guidance and supervision of Krishna's representatives or representatives of the representatives and senior authorities. And if we follow that, then we have a good chance of having this, and consistently, then we have a good chance of being protected. Then we can fill up all the cracks. And therefore, the need for taking guidance and having this spiritual guide, spiritual guru, why it becomes critical. And that, you know, all great personalities have always taken that, including the Lord Himself. Every time Lord Ram, Lord Krishna, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they always took a guru. It was again to show us the criticality of having a guru. Lord Ram would not do anything, not just before his marriage to Sita, but even afterwards, without asking Vishwamitra Muni or Vasishtha Muni, taking the guidance, should I do this? So this was really for us to understand. It's an example for us to follow how critical that is needed. And if we have a, it's not that we find a guru. If we have a sincere desire, then Krishna will arrange. That is the difference. It's not like, because first should be the desire, not only desire, but also a pure desire. If you approach thinking that I'll get something for my benefit, in other words, if you're trying to be slyly cheating ourselves, think that I need a guru so that my business flourishes, or I do better, etc., I get blessings, or I get this, I get that, then you're playing games. If you're trying to be oversmart, it's foolish, because Krishna is much smarter than all of us. So then he would provide a cheating guru. If you have a sincere desire and if you have no other motives, no material motives, then Krishna will arrange in such a way that we will get a guru who will actually give us this guidance and realization. And help us to see where to protect ourselves. Because this also needs from people who are much better equipped than us. So sometimes we may innocently think that we're doing something right. And then intentions may be good, but intentions alone are not the only thing. Because the actions, we'll have to suffer for our actions if they are actually faulty. So because Maya comes in disguise, and her specialty is to come in disguise. And therefore, just like Ravan came, you know, Ravan disguised himself as a sadhu and saintly person, and he came at the door to kidnap Sita. So Sitaji is the eternal consort of Lord Ram, but in her role there as the queen, as the princess, she, we can see in that story that she, there was a limit which Lord Ram and Lakshman had put, she should not cross it. But because she felt that, oh, there's a sadhu, she let her guard down, and she felt that whatever the sadhu wants, I should give, because what can the sadhu, will not harm me. And she crossed the limit. So in the same way, so her thoughts were very innocent, very pure, but that still the consequences were there. So it is, we have to see that we are also answerable, we will be answerable for the actions, not just having sincere thoughts. So we should not be fooled, and therefore this kind of guidance comes from a spiritual master. And Prabhupada would say that this famous line constantly, that Krishna consciousness is simple for the simple and complicated for the complicated. This you've heard many times. But he also said that all we need to do, why is it simple? He says it will be simple for the simple means if somebody is simple enough to understand that he or she has to be submissive and humble. That's it. Submissive and humble, and willing to accept rather than putting their own interpretations or analysis, thinking that I'll accept what I think is right, and maybe this person, the guru, is not fully aware of today's world, and therefore he doesn't know my full situation, and therefore some things are exempt, something. So if we start trying to modify it the way we think it, then we have a problem. So then we are complicating things, and then therefore life will be even more complicated. So simple does not mean that it is devoid of problems. Simple does not mean that you'll have a very easy, comfortable life. I mean, that we have seen Queen Kunti, I mean, all the great devotees have gone through innumerable so-called sufferings. But it is not actually, what we have in store for us, we will need to go through. But it is not that we will be baffled by it. We'll be able to also have the strength to accept it, and we have the association of devotees, which is the most important thing, and that's how we would be, you know. So therefore, to avoid being in Maya's property, we need this Guru Sadhu Shastra protection. Guru is the one who actually is coming through the lineage of Acharyas and is giving it to us in the most contemporary, best way, which is where we are able to carry on our, even the minute details of our life. And when we say Guru means Guru and his representatives, because whoever we have who are directly following the Guru. And Sadhu is again the parampara, the Acharyas, we have so many. And if there's a consistency with what the Guru is saying, when the Sadhu is saying, the Acharyas are saying, and again they are saying exactly what the Shastras are saying, then once that is established, then that's our role of understanding, means accepting a Guru moves into a higher level where it is then action, rather than interpreting and analyzing. So once we follow that, then our we have a very good chance of going through a protected protection from illusion. Even if we do have slip-ups, we will at least have the awareness and the humility to accept it. Because when we are in a situation where we will be defiant, then we will not even accept any corrections. So why association has been stressed so much is also because association of like-minded people, of sadhus, and particularly of our contemporary levels, is because they are the ones who are able to, who will be able to tell us. Sometimes we need some people to tell us, to point up that, you know, this is, we may or may not agree. But unless we welcome that, people will not say it. And if they don't say it, then even if we are, because everyone will make mistakes. But then to correct the mistakes is important. Then it's a temporary lapse, then you can bounce back. So for that also we need to have this association. So I will end here. And any questions? Maybe but just one or two we can have at the most. It's already 9:15. Right, then we'll end here. Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.